Attention, you are now entering the debarkation area. No talking, no smoking.
Welcome to Escape from New York, the official story of the film. This series will look behind the scenes of the forthcoming book that celebrates the making of the movie from 1981.
S.D. Pliskin. He robbed the Federal Reserve Depository. Life sentence, New York Maximum Security Penitentiary.
I'm filmmaker and author John Walsh, and I'll take you on a journey through a dystopian future to discover how John Carpenter's vision has become the ultimate cult film of the last 40 years.
Get a new president.
We're still at war, Pliskin.
I will be speaking with the cast, the crew, and fans of the film, and giving you a unique insight into the making of the book.
You're Snake Pliskin, ain't you?
Snake Pliskin, Duke. The man sent him in here. Something's going down, we need him.
I will reveal details of upcoming events, and there will be a chance to win copies of the book, too.
I can't hear you.
You are the Duke of New York. You're A number one.
Hello, in this episode I'm speaking to James G. Chandler, who's the king of trailers for movies, in particular John Carpenter films, alongside his friend and associate Ash Hamilton from the website Horrorfix. Well, thank you both guys for joining me on this podcast. Now, I suppose you could be described as mega fans for Escape from New York, but in your case, Jim, it's much, much more than that, isn't it?
Yeah, I've been a John Carpenter fan since Halloween came out, and Escape from New York, I collect movie memorabilia, things like TV spots, radio spots, and I've loaned to several releases those things. So a lot of things you see, like teasers, trailers, radio spots, photos, things like that, they are mine. So I've been a fan for years. We live 90 miles from St. Louis, so I've been to some of the sites and to the Bridge and Fox Theater and Union Station.
You say these spots, but I mean, they're quite significant parts of cinema history now, aren't they? So teaser trailers and theatrical trailers, yes, and so on. Where would you find something like that? Because they'd be quite hard to find, I'm sure.
Well, you know, part of it is I've been doing it for so long. I started in the 80s collecting, just collecting trailers. And you go to, I think the first trailers I got were in like a record show. I went to look for records and CDs and stuff back in the 80s. I lived in Indianapolis and I picked up what I thought was a Halloween 3 teaser, and I ended up with a Halloween 3 and a James Bond Octopussy teasers.
And now, Roger Moore is Ian Fleming's James Bond 007 in Octopussy.
You don't really know much about Halloween witchcraft. The last great one took place 3,000 years ago when the hills ran red. Halloween, the dead might be looking in.
Stop it!
The world's going to change tonight, Doctor. Happy Halloween.
Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, the night no one comes home. Rated R, now playing at a theater near you.
Like that, and it's like, hey, this would be great to get more of these. Well, then I found out there's a publication called The Big Reel. I found that in the 90s, and they deal with nothing but film. And they were out of Iowa, and they brought film collectors together, and that's where I started buying all of those. There'd be people that had film and said, here's TV spots, people that just had boxes of these things. And so I bought some of those, and then when eBay came around, and a lot of people who were in The Big Reel started dropping off The Big Reel and going to eBay. So that publication went out of business, but I had picked up a lot of things. There was a place in Canada that had they were a movie poster place, and they had a lot of teasers, or they had a lot of trailers. And so I ended up buying trailers from them. And somebody came in and bought at some point all their 70s trailers. And I was still picking up 80s trailers. I really picked up what I wanted, what I could. And finally, radio spots. I had a few of those. Guy traded me a radio spot for Halloween. I'm a Carpenter fan, a huge Carpenter fan. So that's why Halloween and these other things come up. But so I picked up radio spots and I got those, and it was kind of like, well, I'd like to get more of these. Once eBay came around, it was the world, you know. Then it was like, and you just got to be on it all the time and watching it all the time. So every day I'd have a saved search and I would check it every day. And occasionally you find something. And I found the teaser trailer for Halloween 2. I found, you go to conventions and you find people that have radio spots. And I do reel-to-reel spots a lot. So a lot of people don't collect those. So they're out there and people go, I don't know who to sell these to. And if you find that person, that's when you can get a lot of them. And recently I picked up 30 reels of radio spots and got things like The Exorcist 2 and Clockwork Orange. And
4 years ago, The Exorcist shocked the world. Now, the struggle between good and evil goes on. Exorcist 2, The Heretic. Starring Linda Blair, Richard Burton, Louise Fletcher, Max von Sydow, James Earl Jones. Exorcist 2, The Heretic. Rated R, under 17, not admitted without parent.
So the amp, the format, the radio spots would be on a quarter inch magnetic tape, is that right?
The reel-to-reel tapes, yes.
Yeah. So it's a sort of quarter inch stone quarter inch. Kind of tapes. And the trailers would be mostly 35 millimeter print trailers, yes.
You know, what's funny is like, yes, 35 millimeter. Like when you watch the Escape from New York, the DVD, the special edition, kind of the American one anyway, the two disc that MGM put out, I loaned them the teaser trailer and I think I loaned them two other trailers. And there's a radio spot on there too. That radio spot, it was on a reel tape and it had I think they had there were three spots that showed that two were gone and only one was on there. So it was supposed to originally be three spots. And it's the only reel I've ever gotten where somebody's cut off other spots and like sold one off. So there's still two out there I'm looking for. But yeah, they and I get vinyl, radio spots on vinyl sometimes. Those go for a lot of money. I don't necessarily looking for the format. Get back to your original question. The teasers and things, they're on 35 millimeter. I run across them occasionally on U-matic if I can't find them on 35, or TV spots will be on U-matic or quadruplex, which is a 2-inch format. I had some of those transferred off. I've got Jaws reissue and the ones on the thing, if you have the thing, Blu-ray from Scream Factory, those TV spots are mine. The production reel is mine. And the, what's the other one now? Production reel is mine. Oh, and there's the Mick Garris produced making of. Two of those things are on U-matic and the TV spots were on quadruplex. So all kinds of formats.
So reel to reel is relatively easy to watch, or rather listen back to, a reel to reel magnetic. But how do you watch back for 35 mil? Do you have a Moviola, Steenbeck? No. How do you do it?
What you do is you just look at a few frames and go, this is different than what I've got. And you send it someplace.
Up to the lights. You hold it up to the lights and sort of go.
Yeah, that's actually the only way that you can tell if it's different than what, because so many of these have been watched by now or used. You can't tell how you're going to figure out what they are except by looking at them. So, I ended up, I also loaned the German trailer for the thing. It's on there. That's mine. That was 35. And also the Ice Block teaser was mine. I think trailer number 3 or whatever it is that's on there is mine. And all the trailers on the Screen Factory are mine.
Zwölf Männer haben gerade etwas entdeckt. Vor 1 Million Jahren wurde es unter Schnee und Eis begraben. Jetzt ist es wieder zum Leben erwacht. Tief im Innern. Wo niemand es sehen, hören oder fühlen kann.
Ich weiß, ich bin ein Mensch. Und einige von euch können auch noch Menschen sein. Dieses Ding zeigt sich nicht. Es versteckt sich in einer Imitation. Es kämpft, wenn es sein muss. Wenn wir es herauslocken, können wir es besiegen. Wenn uns das nicht gelingt, wird es uns alle vernichten. Dann hat es gewonnen.
Wollt ihr auf Gary hören? Er kann schon eins von diesen Wesen sein!
Das Ding aus einer anderen Welt. Ein Film von John Carpenter.
So what's the story with this? Because people listening now will think, well, what happened? Did the studio get burgled? I mean, I know, you know, but for people listening, why don't the studio have these assets? Because they would have spent lots of money with advertising companies and so on creating these. So what's the story there?
Well, the funny thing is that back in the 80s, you know, we didn't have DVD. We didn't have really a format that exploited the advertising materials. So it wasn't until Laserdisc, Criterion, I think in 84, I think it was when the first Laserdisc was, started putting things on there. And then Elite Entertainment came out a little while later and started doing specifically horror movies. I don't think anybody really knew that there was a demand or need for these. So the studios, since they only use them for advertising, get rid of them. They just, you know, it's like, hey, we send out trailers. We don't care if we get them back. So they want them back, but what they'll do is they would destroy them or whatever. And I'm finding out there's one major studio, I guess, that doesn't have a lot of their material. They may have a trailer and that's it. And it's a major studio. And I just found that out and got in contact with somebody, and somebody wants me to loan them things now too.
And a lot of these places too would store a lot of materials offsite.
That's true.
That would happen a lot. And I've heard, we're talking 4, sometimes 5 different warehouses.
Yes.
And they would have so much material that it was actually more cost effective for them to let the lease lapse and to have the material auctioned off than to try to find it another space for it.
That's right.
So we've got a lot of material out there. And plus it would change hands so often. Absolutely. That sometimes people would actually buy the space and keep the contents because these are people who bought property.
Yeah.
You know, there are rumors of London After Midnight, that's how the fate that suffered too. You know, there's so much property being owned by these production houses and by these companies just for storage purposes that a lot of it is a matter of, well, also a lot of it's pre-digital.
That's true. Yes.
So as far as bookkeeping, these were handwritten ledgers.
Right.
A lot of time you lose the book, you lose your inventory.
That's right. And then, you know, a lot of these things, a lot of companies that went out of business, they went out of business. Like Avco Embassy went out of business. And from what I know from talking to some people who have been directly involved with the remastering of some movies, Avco Embassy, because they were going out, they didn't care. They didn't want to pay, you know, we're going out of business. We don't have money. We don't have money to store this stuff. They threw away negatives to films.
Yeah. It's a bottom line industry, unfortunately, like everything else.
Right. Exactly.
Like I can reveal some of the story for Escape from New York, because as you say, Bob Remy at Avco got John Carpenter to make the picture there. And then when Bob Remy left and the studio ended up being owned by Dino De Laurentiis in the mid 80s, so I did a book on the making of Flash Gordon that came out last year. And the whole story of Dino's assets from Flash Gordon and from Avco Embassy and Dune and all those films, they were gone when Dino went bankrupt in the mid 80s. So now we're sort of in 2021. This film is owned by the French company Studio Canal. And right. it's through them that this book has been licensed. So they had quite a few sort of interesting photos in the archive. But as with Flash Gordon as well, there aren't the kind of pictures there that are enough to make a making of book. You know, not those really interesting behind the scenes shots and where are the deleted scenes and what could have been and the sketches and the artwork and this, that and the other. And even the original posters, where's the artwork before the text was put on? So, you know, I've been through this process. This is my third sort of film book, currently working on a fourth. And for each one, regardless of how big the picture is, and Flash Gordon cost like $30 million in 1980. Yeah,
that was a lot.
Studio has nothing, you know. And so poor old Studio Canal, who have Flash Gordon now, they don't have any of the trims, the sound trims, the film trims, and none of the props, of course, all of that paraphernalia goes. But they don't even have much of the original assets from the photographs. And so it's kind of like, it's depressing for fans who think that there's a kind of an Aladdin's cave inside film studios where you open a big door and there's everything from The Black Hole or Howard the Duck or Tron or whatever it might be. And as you say, if they've kept the A and B neg roll, that's kind of unusual. The A and B neg roll was found for Escape from New York. For the Blu-ray that was done, or no, the 4K rather, that was done 2 or 3 years ago. So at least they had the neg for that. But more often than not, they're coming off an interpositive or a print. And it's a shame, isn't it, that studios aren't really that fussed. Once a film's out, they think it's kind of disposable. Not today, but in the past.
Well, at the time of Escape from New York, you know, we didn't have the video market we do now. It's like I was in high school from 81 to 85. And by 85, video stores were popping up. They're more common. I lived in a smaller town, so they were common there even. And so, you know, you didn't have a video market. So yeah, you're right. Once this movie was up and going and it had its time, it was sort of like, oh, that it's had its time and it'll show on TV and that'll be it. But then the video market just opened up everything else. And I know on The Fog, I loaned TV spots and the trailers for The Fog. At the time, I loaned them for Laserdisc. And at the time, they didn't have any. They didn't have any. They went to Canal and Canal, we don't have any. Now, I don't know if that's because they hadn't gone through everything. They weren't sure where everything was. And like Ash said, you know, they have written ledgers at that time. So I don't know if they knew where everything was at the time. So who knows? I mean, who knows where this stuff's going to show up?
Tonight, an ABC premiere presentation from the creator of Halloween. Adrian Barbeau, Jamie Lee Curtis, beware.
So what do you guys are hoping to see in the sort of making of Escape from New York book or Escape from New York, the official story of the film, as it's called? What are you hoping would be in there,
Ash?
Well, I am, and now we've talked about, unfortunately, lack of behind-the-scenes stuff. Like, I am a huge behind-the-scenes kind of guy. I like seeing the break between the actual setup of the scene and background. That's always my favorite, of seeing something where only like they've got a partial set. Mm-hmm. Those are my favorite, like BTS photos. It's when you've got an actor that's right at that line between partial set and actual background.
Right.
That's a fourth wall breakdown that I just love seeing. Mm-hmm. I mean, for me, seeing the behind the scenes stuff where you get to see if they're on a soundstage, for example, and it's 360 degrees and it's all enveloping. I mean, it's that kind of stuff. It's always nice to actually see the director in frame.
Yes.
Or to see anybody like a grip in frame, because again, it really sort of like breaks that glass.
Right.
It's that fourth barrier breaking.
There's tons of that in here. So we worked with the official stills person on the film, Kim Goldsted Walker.
Sure.
And some of the technical crew from New World, the Roger Corman company who did the special effects, they had some great behind the scenes stuff that's never been seen before. The model building. And I had more than I could put in the book. I mean, the book's about 200 pages. Nice. Like they say in Jaws, you need a bigger boat. I need a bigger book. You know,
do we get any matte paintings?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Great.
All of the matte paintings are here. They've been separated.
Really?
And I've got a fabulous photograph of the Skotak brothers preparing the matte painting with a foreground model in a color photograph.
Oh, that's fantastic.
So you get to see scale, because once you put a person in the shots, you really get a sense of scale for the size of the mats and the model work and so on. And I love that stuff.
Yeah, well, Jim had mentioned your involvement with some Harryhausen work.
I'm a trustee of the Ray and Diana Harryhausen Foundation, so I have been for years. So.
And I love BTS photos that are scale shots.
Oh, yes.
Any of the Harryhausen stuff. I mean, it's really hard to really appreciate the artisan craftsmanship of Harryhausen's work exactly.
So there's me with the Kraken. I was 18 years old, and there's the Kraken, and there's Ray Harryhausen. And Ray, of course, a very tall man. But it was great to see the kind of the models up close, because it's great, isn't it? For scale,
that's awesome.
Model special effects is just that, isn't it? You know, it's like watching one of those TV shows where they reveal magician secrets. You know, you shouldn't watch, but you kind of are drawn to it. And I love that stuff.
I still have the original line of 81 Mattel Clash of the Titans figures.
Oh,
yeah. So for me, it was always actually being able to position the Kraken because the toy, each of the four arms were on ball joints.
Oh, nice.
And they were stiff enough that you could actually, that was some of the first time I forced my parents to do like stop motion work, because that we took photographs. Mm-hmm. Of the arms in different positions because of the ball joints of the Kraken for the Mattel toy.
Well, that brings up something. I think what we like is we not only, I think as fans, like to watch the movie, we want to feel like we can sort of feel what that world is like, right? I mean, I sent you pictures of the bridge, the Chain of Rocks bridge, and I've been there. And it's like, okay, so what part of this bridge did they film at? More on the St. Louis side, which I would imagine. Not too far from the end. And, you know, you go and you sort of get a scale for how everything could be set up, or where, you know, where they could have built the wall, or, you know, those kinds of things. It just, I think you, when you go someplace and you go where they've shot a movie, you actually stand in that three-dimensional space. And I've been to the lighthouse in Point Reyes, and I've, you know, been there, and I actually, it's weird that you stand there in that three-dimensional space. And I think that adds something to it if you're a fan.
And I suppose you guys know that John Carpenter was inspired to write this after the Watergate scandal and the resignation of President Nixon.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
So it's interesting that at that time, you know, President Nixon was probably thought to have been, you know, maybe a bad president. And he based the character that Donald Pleasance plays on kind of bad president. Donald Pleasance doesn't seem that terrible, really, does he now? I'd probably vote for him.
And Nixon, strangely, does not seem all that terrible now either.
Exactly. Right.
Well, I mean, we've also, you know, in seceding years, like, we've really been able to up the ante on political villains here in the States. So,
yes. Yes, you really have. You know, well,
we're doing our best to give Hollywood more and more inspiration each year.
Exactly. So Donald Pleasance doesn't seem all that bad. He would probably beat any candidate running today, wouldn't he?
He's far more the lower end of the spectrum now than what we've had since then.
Well, it took John Carpenter some time to convince Pleasance, because he's English. He felt he couldn't imagine, you know, he couldn't carry the American accent, and that he wouldn't be believed by audiences. So how he kind of made it work is that he said that he was the offspring child of Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan in this alternative future. And he kind of had that in mind. And it's a shame we don't see more of the president. Do you feel that there could have been more for it from Air Force One and more of a buildup of his character?
Yeah, sure. Why not? I mean, we don't get a lot of backstory on Donald Pleasance as the president. And I think that would have been great. I think they wanted to move things along. So I don't think building the backstory was necessarily the thought, but I would have liked to have seen more backstory. I think that would have been great. Would have added something to it, I think.
And of course, the bank robbery scene, which has been reinstated now on the 4K, that would have made a great pre-title sequence, wouldn't it? Because it gives you the whole reason why he's going to prison, and this idea that everything had to be 90 minutes because theater owners wanted that kind of crisp three or four screenings per day. It's a shame, isn't it? It wouldn't happen today, would it? People would happily sit for 3 hours.
Well, I think.
Yeah, thank you, Marvel.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Well, don't you think there was something in the opening where I think Snake is a little, you know, he's conflicted. He wants to take off, or he's going to stay back for his buddy, and he gets caught. You know, so it kind of makes him look like, oh, this guy has a heart. You know, he's pretty hardened when he goes in. You don't feel that, okay, he really, you know, he's like, hey, he's a normal guy too. When you go in without that, it's kind of like, this is a no-nonsense guy, and he's pretty hardened by the world he lives in. But then when, you know, at the end, you only really see him kind of soften up a little bit when Maggie's there, and he, you know, they've got the gun and the whole bit, and she, he knows she's gonna, you know, kill herself and, you know, and try to take out the Duke at the same time.
Well, I mean, remember also a lot of pre-80s futurism in films too. You know, we were just entering into this idea of the nuclear post-apocalyptic sci-fi, or, you know, vision.
Yeah.
So a lot of what we had before this, for example, was either leading up to an event, or we were seeing post-event, but it was mainly, you know, we shot a lot of that in Arizona, in the Southwest,
right.
You know, anything with hills and sand.
Right, exactly.
So sort of getting into this at this point, there was obviously much more emphasis on what the social political climate would be. And so instead of our heroes being forged out of trauma, they were also sort of being forged out of their direct environment and their interactions with the government. Yep. So it was a much different take than what we had really seen on hardened heroes. Yep. Hardened heroes we'd seen before were very much environmental, and we didn't really have that, again, the social political aspect to it. And then when we finally get a character like Snake, like it's much more faceted than that, in my opinion, anyways.
I agree.
Yeah, and even the story format, you know, the idea of setting it around the time frame. You know, we see restaurant programs now that have to kind of sort things out in 24 hours. But he was dropped in, wasn't he? In 24 hours, you've got to get the president or everyone's dead. And it's quite an arbitrary sort of narrative device, isn't it, to give someone just 24 hours because the prison's still going to be there. Snake's still going to be there 2 days later. But that was quite innovative, really, at the time. No one else was doing that sort of thing and putting very obvious time limits. And so you could show the clock, that enormous digital watch, which looks uncomfortable, but very cool.
But I think, is what really got me was Escape from LA. I was so excited to see that movie. And the trailer is great. It's one of the best trailers, period. And it has the scene, the Bangkok Rules scene. And I think had the movie had that attitude and that kind of thing, it would have been more like the first movie. But I think, and this is going to sound strange, I think the commentary, when they did the commentary for Escape from New York, sort of ruined that, sort of tainted it, because they talked about how much humor there was in there. So then when they were writing, I think the sequel came out to be more overt humor and ended up permeating into the movie more. I mean, it seemed, you know, there's some odd things like where, you know, Snake Plissken's surfing and then Steve Buscemi has the look on his face. It's like, well, that's not exactly the Snake from the first movie. I don't think he would have done that. And that's why I really, the first movie to me is really, I don't think you could ever do a sequel, a remake, a reboot, whatever, that would ever touch the original. The original is good for what it is because of the time it was made. The fact I think they had to sit so long. And like Ash mentioned, you know, I don't know the background on how the writing was done at the time and things from the 70s, since it was written back then. I think it shows a lot of that. And it just
shows a different America entirely.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's just like those things coming together. I don't think you could repeat that. Do you, Ash?
No. And just one distinction too, that is one thing that it, unfortunately, is a huge criticism of mine about Escape from LA, is that they deviated a lot from the blue and gray color palette of Escape from New York.
Yes, they did.
And I think that tonally, it was, I understand that they're in LA, but I think that tonally it was so different because of the color palettes that it felt like a completely different film. And I think we needed some of that connective tissue that we didn't get.
I think your director of photography, changing director of photography, obviously did that.
When I spoke to Dean Cundey about that for the book, he was saying that he got no notes. You know, Avco Embassy was a small company. This was a big budget, $6 million, six times what the Fog cost, but still quite low. You know, Flash Gordon cost $30 million. So $6 million is still a modest budget, but Avco Embassy didn't have time to send execs down to send notes on this, that, and the other. And Dean Cundey, who went on to lights, as you know, other John Carpenter films, and he worked with Steven Spielberg, Jurassic Park, Bob Zemeckis, Back to the Future. He was telling me every other film he's been on, every film, even now, Dean is quite an established guy. He gets notes from executives and office people. It's like, how could you imagine sending Dean Cundey a notes? So if you jump forward to when Escape from LA was done at Paramount, of course, this is at a time when Paramount had plenty of young men in suits and young ladies who could go down on the set and scribble notes for probably the DP, for Kurt Russell, for John Carpenter. And Carpenter, of course, was in a bit of a career cul-de-sac, let's be nice. So you can see how the pressure to want to do a sequel with a big budget meant those compromises with lighting, with characters, with casting, and tonally as well. It didn't feel like the indie film from 1981, because Paramount wanted something bigger. I think they wanted to bounce it into a franchise, like with Star Trek. And because Paramount had that almost false start with Star Trek the Motion Picture, which was expensive, plodding, but Wrath of Khan really kicked it into gear. I think they were hoping to do something here. And of course, it didn't happen. And it's a shame because it's tainted that legacy. The idea of going back and touching it again, as you said, Jim, you wouldn't want to see another remake, would you? Or a reimagining?
It's fine if they do it, but it just will not live up to the original. It just can't. I don't see how it could. It just can't. I think sometimes you get things like the original Night of the Living Dead. You can remake that movie as much as you want, and they look great. Some of them look great and they're fun, but something about that first movie, about the people that worked on it, the fact that it was low budget. I think the fact the execs stayed out of it helped the movie for Escape from New York. I mean, I'm sure it would have looked different. It would have felt different. I mean, they wanted Charles Bronson originally, right,
That's what Bob wanted. Bob Remy said, let's do this and we'll do it with Charles Bronson because Death Wish was a big hit. But John Carpenter said, I don't want to go that road because I don't want to happen to me what happened on Spartacus, where where Kirk Douglas was pushing and pushing and pushing until the director was fired and then had him replaced with someone he thought could be a yes man, Stanley Kubrick, which of course it turned out to be the opposite of that. So I think John felt on his first kind of major film with a major budget, he didn't want to be hamstrung by having a potentially a leading artist who was bigger than the director. And that often is an unhappy time for everyone. But to get Kurt Russell, a handsome leading man who was more of a romantic lead, his biggest role had been in Elvis, a television movie, which was successful, but again, softened his appeal. You wouldn't, if you were the studio head, you'd probably think twice, wouldn't you, as well, about Kurt Russell?
I would. Yes. Mm.
But we can't think, and we can't think of him, anyone else in that role now, can we?
I think you're better off with, somebody like Kurt Russell, where if they're able to change their appearance enough and he doesn't look like the good guy, and all of a sudden his appearance is completely different. You're like, okay, well, what is this? We're in new territory. And I think that's absolutely worked for him. Absolutely. And then he was able to do MacReady, in The Thing. I think that was the next movie. I mean, The Thing, he says in the commentary for The Thing that he's got the hair still there from Escape from New York.
Yeah.
So he just grew the beard and there he was.
Deborah Hill and John Carpenter respected the idea of bringing an established actor in. So that's why you have people like Lee Van Cleef, Ernest Borgnine, all of these actors who kind of bring gravitas, Harry Dean Stanton, and bring that audience in. So if you've seen them in Westerns or in other thrillers, that helps, doesn't it? Creates that ensemble of confidence.
Yes.
Well, you've also got veteran actors. And I think that when we're talking about a remake, for example, I think that's something that we would probably see a huge shift in we have seen a huge shift in demographically actors that are being cast in remakes who are far younger than the veteran actor counterpart in the originals. I think unfortunately, we'd see an Escape from New York with far fewer actors over 40.
Yes, I agree. Yeah, you wouldn't get an Ernest Borgnine or similar, would you?
Oh, no.
In fact, Ernest Borgnine wanted to play the prison guard. He wanted to play the hawk parts played by Lee Van Cleef.
Really?
So he really campaigned hard for that. And John Carpenter rang him up and said, look, I had you in mind when I wrote Cabbie. And I think that sort of that plays his actor's vanity. But you can't imagine all of those characters being recast by anyone else. I mean, it would be it'd be quite incredible. But I think Ernest Borgnine didn't really understand. I mean, he understood the script, of course, but I don't think he understood how a film like this could get great appeal. And of course, it's one of the films that The Black Hole and The Poseidon Adventure are perhaps, certainly for myself, are the three films I most remember him from. And yet I think he wouldn't consider those to be amongst his best work because he won his Oscar for Marcy, of course, was it in the 1950s?
Well, I think at that time, too, that a lot of actors who had been around, especially a lot of those who had been in both television and feature films, didn't understand the longevity or staying impact of genre films.
Right. It's like, we're not watching War and Peace. We're watching things from the 60s, 70s, that were genre films. War and Peace was a huge movie made by Paramount, but most people don't go, I'm going to watch War and Peace today. I mean, this is not, you don't get that excited.
You don't get your friends together to watch War and Peace.
Right.
Now look at the Harryhausen films. None of those were B pictures. They're all A pictures, but on very tiny budgets. And when they came out, none of the studios put them through the Oscars corridor. None of the studios gave them color advertising. And yet Sony Pictures or Columbia that made most of the Harryhausen films, they haven't restored many of the great films that came out with big stars of the day, William Holden and others.
Right.
The Harryhausen films, some of them are in 4K. So, we've been working on that restoration program. John Carpenter's films, virtually all now in 4K. And when John Carpenter's Escape from New York was up for the Oscars, the guys down at New World, they put together this wonderful showreel of all these special effects. And they couldn't even get people to view it on the Academy's members list because of the kind of snobbishness about, it's come from Roger Corman's people and it's not proper FX people. And John Dykstra had been asked to do the effects on this, and he said yes. And then when they found that it was going to be a $3 million bill plus $1 million for John Dykstra up front, not that he's not worth that, he's very good at FX, they ended up doing the whole picture, all of the FX, for $350,000. So, and yet none of those need to be replaced. You'd never think of having a CGI rehash of any of Carpenter's films, and certainly not Escape from New York. That flypast through Manhattan still works beautifully.
Do you feel that there was also a mentality there between the original Escape from New York and Escape from LA that because of the technology, they almost felt that they were trying to correct certain aspects of the filmmaking? And do you think that that was maybe one of the flaws?
I think so. I think it's about enhancing, isn't it? They think, look, we can go Escape from New York and make it 2.0. You know, we can upscale it. We have computer graphics. We have a bigger budget. In LA, things are more exciting. And I think they've forgot the close proximity and the closed-in nature of the walled city of New York. The sequel should have been in New York. It shouldn't have been another town randomly chosen. If they'd done the sequel to Escape from New York, a return to New York, because the president rather foolishly crashed again for a second time, or maybe the Queen of England accidentally, you know, landed there. I think that would have been even better. They could have seen some of the characters as they are now 30 years later. Maybe Maggie didn't die after all. I just think it's a shame. This idea of reinventing the wheel with corners never really works. I mean, what's been a good remake? Even Phil Tippett doesn't like the John Carpenter remake of The Thing. He prefers the original. So, but I think The Thing and The Fly are two examples of really good remakes. And maybe 1978's The Invasion of the Body Snatchers. They're my little trio of super good remakes that deserve to be stood on their own two feet. But remakes generally, it's Clash of the Titans was remade and Ray Harryhausen wasn't happy.
Yeah. I think when you're talking remakes, the thing, that was done a little differently because it was, I think, name only, because they went back to the original material, wrote a screenplay based on the short story rather than remaking the movie. So I looked at that one a little different. That's why I think that one did as well as it was as good as it was.
What's the worst remake or worst sequel? Do you have one in mind that's the worst? I'm thinking Sting 2. So I don't know if you can go lower than that bar of Sting 2. Which actually is not bad. Oh. If you want to laugh.
Psycho is, I think, I know why they redid that. Supposedly,
so that would be the most unnecessary, do you think, in your opinion?
I think it's most unnecessary. I mean, it was there was supposedly a studio exec that somebody said that their kids didn't like black and white movies, so they remade it. It's like, well, what's the point? I mean, in 1960, Alfred Hitchcock did that stylistically. He did it, you know. Part of the reason was because of the blood, you know, they would get. The shower scene cut if it was red. So part of the reason was that they did it black and white for that. So I don't understand, you know.
But what was worse for Psycho? Was the remake worse by Gus Van Sant, or were the three sequels, one directed by Anthony Perkins, worse?
I actually liked 2, 3, and 4. I liked the Psycho.
I just love the "Would you like a sandwich" line when he hits her with the shovel.
Oh, I think there's probably a whole nother podcast to do there. What's our worst top three remakes or worst top three sequels?
One that I found just particularly bland. Like, and I think one of the worst offenses in movie making for me is something that's bland. Like, I would rather see someone go out on the ledge and fail horribly, but fail interestingly, than have someone, you know, shoot for the stars and then don't make it past the living room couch. It's just so absolutely banal and bland.
Right.
And I would almost have to give that award to the Day of the Earth Stood Still remake, which I love the original Day of the Earth Stood Still. And again, an unnecessary remake that just came across as being so particularly bland and uninteresting. And it's such a disservice to the original. I think that Cameron's director's cut of The Abyss is a far better remake of the Day of the Earth Stood Still than the Day of the Earth Stood Still remake, in my opinion.
We're bringing us back to the Escape from New York book. Of course, we got a section with map painters, and we have some photography of James Cameron that hasn't been seen before. Great. So we've got some great shots in there of Jim Cameron and the work that he did on the picture. And, you know, it's lovely because it's been a launch pad for lots of people, you know, between Alan Howarth, who did the music, and Dean Cundey, who was the DOP. Yes. You know, so many people didn't necessarily get their start, but got really noticed on this picture is where they really got noticed and started. Dean said to me, you know, he was always available for John up until sort of 1985 for Big Trouble in Little China. But then he said, I was getting even bigger and better offers, so I was less available. And he said he felt bad about that. So I think a lot of people have a lot of warmth and kindness and camaraderie around John Carpenter than they do for nearly any other directors they've worked with.
Yeah, I was talking to somebody about that recently, and we always talk about John Carpenter must be the best director ever, because you know they keep releasing things and we keep buying the stuff. You know, as much as George Lucas is beloved, they don't release the original Star Wars that many times. They do release it, but not in so many versions, commentaries, stuff dug up on it another time. It's 5 years later, we'll release it again. It's, you know, how many copies of American Graffiti are out there? Not many. It's just, it's released and it's like, okay, but Carpenter fans, you'll release, you know, multiple versions of the thing. I think I just bought like three or four for the 4K from different versions. You know, I've been waiting on those and those all showed up. And then, you know, there's just different movies. Halloween, every, 5 years, they're putting something new on that. So,
but what about the less loved Carpenter films? I'm a big fan of Memoirs of an Invisible Man, which I think is a fine film. I like that film.
The problem I have is when you start saying it's John Carpenter, people get this idea, and having his name not so prominent on that one is, I think, if you don't know it's a Carpenter film, you watch the film and you don't think about it, I think you really, really enjoy it. And then you find out it's John Carpenter's like, oh, okay. But I think you would enjoy it if you don't know it so much.
Well, you know my love for Prince of Darkness. So.
Yes, absolutely.
I think Prince of Darkness is a far more progressive horror film than almost anything that was actually created probably in the preceding 2 or 3 years. And even afterwards, like Prince of Darkness. And in my opinion, I would love to see Prince of Darkness not as a remake, but as an episodic television series. I think out of Carpenter's works, I would love to see that happen.
I think there's a lot of potential for that. I think there is.
Well, there was a lot of remake talk when I was writing this book. There was lots of people speaking to me about, you know, is a streaming service involved? You know, is John Carpenter still involved? You know, can something else be done? I found some artwork that Drew Struzan did for that's never been seen, that's in the book.
Really?
Yeah. And he was awesome. Involved with a possible...
Well, there's my selling point right there.
Yeah. Well, make sure you order it. It's on Amazon now. So if you want to pre-order it, you can get it. And my last couple of books sold out quite quickly. And they had to go to a second print. So thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
You helped keep the lights on here in London by pre-ordering my book. Very kind of you. We're having a crisis of energy over in London. So every little helps.
I think as soon as I saw it, I went and pre-ordered it. And I mean, as soon as I saw it, it was like hardcover. And it's like, great, done. I mean, it's, you know, I looked at what else you'd done and it's like, this is great. I'm going to grab that. No problem. So yeah. I would tell anybody to get that. Because I haven't seen your other books. I've seen what you've done. I will probably end up buying those as well.
Get the sets. I'll fly over specially to sign them for you.
Perfect.
No problem in doing this. But look, gents, it's been a real pleasure that you take the time to speak to me here in London today. And, you know, maybe I can come back on again and we can chat more about other films and other books. And it would be marvelous. It'd be marvelous.
That would be fantastic. We actually have our own show that we do weekly. We would love to have you on.
Yeah.
That's splendid.
We'd love to do just a Harryhausen retrospective, but that could be fantastic for me.
So. I would love that. It could be, there's my Harryhausen, but Harryhausen, the lost movies, all the unmade films that Ray Harryhausen didn't make, and the films he was asked to make. Do you know, in the early 80s, Ray Harryhausen was asked to work on the first Marvel film?
Really?
It's in this big book. The book is shown at actual scale. It's so big. Look at that. Either I'm really small or this book is really big.
No reason to paint a wall. You could just put the book up.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, absolutely. You can make a house with my books. I had access to, you know, Ray was not keen for people to know all of the films he was involved with because he thought that people might see it as a book of failure. So it took us a long time with his daughter, Vanessa, we're trustees of his foundation. We kind of thought long and hard about whether we release this marvelous material because even the films he made, there was dozens of scenes that he had to cut for financial reasons or because time reasons or technology reasons. The skeleton fight for Jason the Argonauts was going to be set at nighttime, but the censors said, no, if you set it at nighttime, we'll up your certificate to 15. And you know, the skeletons, when they come out of the ground, were meant to come from hell, not just from a random patch of ground. Or the seven-headed Hydra protects Hades, the entrance to hell. And inside, the souls of dead soldiers were brought back to life by the Hydra to protect the fleece. It's like, oh wow, that makes much more sense. But in the film, it's kind of like a bit random that some people who were sunbathing died on a bit of beach and suddenly came back to life. It's like, who stole my towel? It must be Jason.
Right, yeah, it was a battlefield. We'll just say it was a battlefield. Yeah, we'll fill in the gaps that way. Right?
Exactly. Or a Greek beach. You never know.
Just random fallen soldiers are everywhere. Yeah.
So, Jim, is there a trailer that you're looking to find, the holy grail of trailers that you'd love to have in your collection?
Yeah, there's, I want to find the Alice Cooper Welcome to My Nightmare trailer for the theatrical release of the concert film. There is, I think, one more trailer for The Thing, which was a, when you look at the bands on the trailers, it tells you this is trailer 4, and it looks like there might be one trailer that I'm missing. So those, I picked up the Halloween 2 teaser. That was a big one. And there are people, it's up on YouTube. And there is a release that it came out with. And I think there's another release coming very soon that it's coming out on. And people think it's fan-made because they've never seen it. So it was so rare.
Condensed investor reels for The Thing?
The production reel is on there. It's from U-Matic. There was one actually recently up on eBay. It was a 35 millimeter print of the production reel, and that would have been great in high def. I don't know who got it. I saw that it went for $250 or $300. I just didn't have money at the time, but but the Alice Cooper is probably the big one. I would like to get that, and maybe that elusive extra Thing trailer, something like that. That's kind of what I'm looking for. That's not a lot that's missing. There's been so many trailers released for so many movies now, but I've got trailers like the Hanny Calder I was mentioning there. The one that's on the Blu-ray is actually an international trailer. I have the 35 of the American, and like Looking for Mr. Goodbar, which is not out. I'd like to see that one actually transferred. I have that one. I may do that. I've got a Caddyshack teaser that I don't think anybody's ever seen before. So, I mean, not since its release, but
that Caddyshack teaser could be double billed with Sting 2, I think.
Caddyshack 2.
Unless we forget the abomination that was Caddyshack 2.
Well, maybe people listening might be able to help you with that search. Well, I hope you guys are successful, and I look forward to speaking to you again very soon, I hope.
Definitely.
That'd be great.
I think so. Thank you so much.
Have a great weekend. Yes.
Thanks. You too.
And now we're going to finish off with Jim's fully restored HBO TV spot for the trailer of Escape from New York. Enjoy.
New York, 1997. The entire city is a walled maximum security prison. The bridges are mined. The rivers are patrolled. And the United States Police Force has everything under control.
I'm going in.
One man must go in where no man has ever gotten out. His nightmare has just begun.
Heard you were dead.
The greatest escape of them all is about to blow the future apart. Escape from New York.
Hold on.
Copyright in Escape from New York, the official story of the film, is owned by John Walsh and Titan Books Limited, under license from Studio Canal. This recording may not be reproduced in whole or in part without written permission from us. The views expressed within these podcasts do not necessarily reflect those of the associated companies or its employees. For further terms and conditions, please contact us via our Facebook page, Escape from New York, the official story of the film.